We have with us again today, after having done a pre-record, we have Dave McGowan with us, who's working on a very interesting and very, I should say, arousing series called Inside the LC, The Strange But Mostly True Story of Laurel Canyon and the Birth of the Hippie Generation. We did a pre-record, as we said. He's on live now. A lot of you folks might want to ask questions and make some comments. We've got a ton of stuff that came through, emails to that effect, and I think we'll start the show off with that, if that's okay. So, Dave, thanks a lot for coming back, and I would say you got a live one here.
Yeah, it seems to be taking on a life of its own. This is actually, I think, the third interview I've done in the last week or so, and I got two more lined up. All of a sudden, I'm a very popular guy.
Well,
which paradoxically is slowing me down on finishing up this series now, because I'm just getting inundated with emails and interview requests, and it's kind of weird. I'm not used to being such a popular guy.
Well, this too shall pass.
I'm used to working in obscurity, you know, and just not having anybody really, not too many people other than my devoted followers, my small cult of devoted followers who pay much attention to what I have to say. So it's kind of weird to have this sudden popularity.
Well, you know, well, then good for you in a sense, because obviously when you put something out like that, no matter how people feel, I guess, about politics, Dave, no matter how they feel about Flight 93, blah, 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 everybody in my cohort, which you were probably a little bit just beyond, I mean, like I said, I got, like, what, 9 years on you. But, I mean, you understand what that was all about. Anyway, a lot of those folks actually do get it. I guess we've lived long enough that we realize we've been lied to. I think that happens with age. I think this has been happening for some time. The older folks always said stuff to the younger folks, and I will admit, I listened to it and looked at them and go, yeah, okay, Grandpa, take a hike. He was right. I was wrong. But along with music, though, this is a very special thing. Growing up inside of it, I thought this was a very organic thing, and we're going to get into that definition of it. I'm going to ask you for your definition of it, because some of the questions that came in wanted to know about whether or not this whole thing was rigged or whether partly it was rigged, et cetera, et cetera. But let me, if you want to give us any comments with regard to that, by all means, because if you don't, or after you do, I'd like to pass some comments and questions by you.
Well, I certainly grew up believing that it was organic. I think I mentioned, it's getting hard for me to remember what I've covered in these various forums now. I think we talked before about that I was born in 1960 and actually sort of came of age in the mid-late 70s. But I always considered myself a child of the 60s, and that was the music that I listened to and the fashions that I wore. And, you know, I mean, I was wildly up with my peers when I went to college, because it was like, I started college in, I went to junior college, and I transferred to UCLA, I think, in like 1980 or 1981, which was the dawn of the Reagan era. And the whole campus was like filled with all these preppies, you know, wearing Izod Lacoste shirts and topsiders.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was like the official uniform, and here's this 60s throwback wandering the campus, you know, bare feet and long hair. So I totally bought into it, pretty much my entire life up until maybe like, 10 years ago. I started having my doubts and, you know, started reading things like Martin Lee's Acid Dreams and, various other works that kind of called into question, you know, just how much of it was organic. But I always believed that at least the music, the soundtrack of the 60s, was real and organic. And unfortunately, in the last year and a half, I've even begun to seriously question that, and that's sort of what brought about this series, which I began with a quote from Stephen Stills' song For What It's Worth, "There's something happening here, what it is ain't exactly clear." And I have to say that after close to a year and a half now of digging through this, it's still not it still ain't exactly clear, but I'm hoping that by the time I complete this journey, it will have all come into some kind of a focus.
All right. Fair enough, and let me run by you. This is a comment, and you know, I'm not saying I agree with it or not. It doesn't make a difference. I mean, this is what the folks are thinking, and let me run this by you.
Okay.
That you guys started talking about a lot of these musicians from the 60s that were children of people in the military. It was real cool that you mentioned Jim Morrison before his name was even brought up. I said to myself out loud, yeah, such musicians like Jim Morrison. And you guys mentioned his name. However, I had no clue that Jim Morrison's father was involved in the Gulf of Tonkin incident. That was real news to me. If this is true, then Morrison obviously knew what really happened there leading to the Vietnam War. Now, I'll stop right there. I don't really think he might have, but Dave, do you have any information to the fact that he did? And if so, does that make a difference?
No, I do not have any specific information that he knew. I mean, he knew, obviously, that his dad was deployed in that arena. I mean, he basically saw him off. I have a picture of him on the bridge.
On the bridge,
ship,
yeah.
With his father in January of 1964, not long before he shipped off to go over to that part of the world. The incident occurred in August of 64, so I mean, it was just literally just months before the ship set sail. So he knew his father was there. He knew that his father was the commanding officer of the fleet that was there. So I mean, you know, I suppose he could have deduced that his dad was directly involved, but I don't have any specific information that.
Well, no, I mean, and like I said, I can understand the individual running with that, and he might in fact be true. So let me finish up with his next paragraph. He said, more reason to prove that he was definitely murdered. All right, now hold that for a second. He probably spoke too much. Imagine being someone working in intelligence and knowing that there was a real famous musician out there in the world whose father was there at the Gulf of Tonkin. Obviously, this man's son would know the truth of what really happened, and his popularity would obviously pose a threat to national security. If this is true about Morrison, then it is final. He was definitely murdered. That's just to name a few, of course, with the people we're talking about. But again, we really can't say. Well, I mean, you tell me. Was Morrison whacked, or did he do himself?
To my mind, there's two possibilities. If he did indeed die, when we're told he did, and bearing in mind that there was never any body produced, there was no autopsy, there was no service, they didn't even announce his death until he was allegedly in the ground. He was buried within 4 days, supposedly, despite the fact that he was a U.S. national and a very famous one. They cleared all the hurdles somehow and got him got everything done and his body in the ground within 4 days. Before it was even announced that he was dead. So by the time they had announced that he was gone, it was basically, but there's nothing to see here, you know, don't bother coming around because he's already buried. There's no, you know, I mean, nobody ever saw the body. There was no autopsy done, no service held. So the first question is, did he even die in Paris, which is an open question in my mind. But if he did in fact die over there, then I would say that there's a very, very, very high chance that he was murdered, yeah.
Also, you have to understand something as we go into this season, especially in Florida, which we've not had to worry too much about, but as dry as we've been, it is now the hurricane season. However, I just want to say to you folks on the East Coast, there may be some kind of disruption due to storms on the East Coast. This is something that we might have to live with if those things happen to visit us in Florida on Wednesday. So if you've got some issues that you might think are contributed to the weather, they in fact are. Anybody else who's trying to listen to the show, you can, if you're having a problem, go ahead and refresh and try to click in that way and tell me how you make out. Yeah, we really don't know about Morrison, but of course, this isn't just an isolated case, but we'll get back to that a little bit later.
Yeah. What I like, Morrison had also, he had told a number of interviewers, he had talked about sort of reinventing himself. He said he could see himself having a radical career change and sort of transforming into the same person. I mean, the guy who just... Yeah, he was a bit of a changeling, and he had talked about you know, basically just sort of reemerging as a completely different individual, completely different profession and everything else. So I think there's a lot of open questions about whether Jim Morrison really died over there in Paris.
All right, we also have a caller, let's take them now, Dave. Hello, caller. You're on. Nope.
No.
I got a message from the producer saying prank call, they are gone. That's okay. Let me just say this now, folks. If you do want to call in, you can do so on 333-9009. And when you call in, you're not going to get somebody who's going to hook you in as a screener. But if you call and then you start to hear the show, you are in and we will get to you. So you're not going to hear anybody say anything to you. You hear the show and you call in, you're there. So be that as it may. Also, let me just say this also, that you can also send emails to visigoth@hotmail.com, visigoth@verizon.net. You can use MSNIM, the messenger, and that would be Visigoth. And, again, we're hearing from people that things are a little crazy, but this is summertime. Well, you know, for the most part, summertime in a lot of places in America, and certainly that is the case here in Florida. So, you know, things will happen with the weather. If you get bounced out, it's probably due to that. Come back in if you can. If you're having a hard time listening to the conversation, then go ahead and refresh. Okay. And that's what I'm getting for the most part here. So, Dave, I have to do a little bit of maintenance here because everything's coming through on my screen. But on to a second item, if you would. And this is from a listener from over in Paris. Let's see. Okay, here's a couple of questions that being posed. Dave mentioned that only 2 years ago he was completely unaware of Laurel Canyon. Be interesting to know what tipped him off in that direction, his path to discovery, so to say. What do you think?
It was actually a book that my eldest daughter got for me for Christmas. Not this past Christmas, but the one before. A book called Laurel Canyon, written by a guy named Michael Walker. It was fairly newly released at the time. And it covers the Laurel Canyon scene. It kind of introduced me to the fact that this sort of remote, isolated neighborhood in L.A. had been home to all this was just amazing array of musicians. And there was a lot of little clues, a lot of little warning bells that went off in my head as I was reading this, sort of reading between the lines. And so ever since then, I've been reading everything that I can get my hands on about that era, just every book and magazine article and web post and everything else that I can get my hands on, ferreting out all the little sordid details that are, you know, sort of hidden in the mainstream accounts of that era.
But that had to be something also, Dave, that you weren't really, you know, you didn't need all that kind of priming. I mean, it was kind of probably there anyway, and this gave you a little bit of a trigger to go do it?
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. But, I mean, the thing that just instantly drew me to the story and that was so fascinating to me is that it's so close to home, you know? I mean,
oh, that's right, yeah.
So close to me, and it's somewhere that I can actually go and visit. I mean, you know, I can jump in my car and in 15, 20 minutes be at these places, you know, seeing them for real, how they look today, and sort of getting a feel and a vibe for the place. So I was just instantly drawn to the story by you know, a number of factors. And one of the key ones of which is that it happened right in my backyard here, and I didn't even know about it. That's, you know.
That's the way things are.
Yeah, I was kind of offended by that in a way that, you know, I've lived here all my life and I've been researching this stuff for a good number of years, and yet they pulled the wool over my eyes on something that happened right behind my back, you know, so that's...
How dare they? I know.
Yeah, exactly, how dare they?
But it's always in your own neighborhood, you don't know what the heck is going on.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to go on with some questions and comments from... Erky out in Paris. I'd like to hear both of your views on the relationship between the organic and inorganic. In other words, something was very real and authentic during the 60s, organic, and something was contrived, inorganic. how did one influence the other, and to what level? I'll stop right there. There's a third part to this, but you tell me what your take is, because I came to this of late also as to what might have been, you know, rigged. What do you think about what really truly was an evolution, if you would, or a revolution, and what might have been also either injected into it or, you know, something other that turned it down a side street?
More and more I'm of the opinion that what we think of as the 60s counterculture, which is the whole hippie flower child, freak, whatever term you want to apply to it, movement, I'm really leaning heavily towards believing that entire thing was a fraud, every aspect of it from beginning to end, and that there was a whole series of very real movements that were budding in the 1960s, in the early 60s, a budding anti-war movement, a budding civil rights movement, a budding women's rights movement, a budding Black Power movement, through the Panthers and whatnot. And I think most, if not all of those, were very legitimate. And this whole sort of hippie thing just kind of moved in and overshadowed over that, all of that, and sort of became identified in people's minds with what the 60s were all about. And so I think that whole aspect of it was a sham. That makes any sense.
Well, you make a good point. When you went back, and I think you quoted, I don't know if it was Abby Hoffman or whatever, saying, you know, the anti-war protesters were protesting the war in Vietnam before the hippie generation or the flower power children came on the scene. Now, that is not necessarily exclusive what you said. So can we assume also that the real hardcore political elements were against the war, and then all of a sudden the love children come through and either kind of help or hinder what's going on? What's your take on that as far as what your research revealed?
Yeah, I mean, basically the way that I understand it is that there was an anti-war movement underway, largely on college campuses, you know, with the professors and their students and whatnot, and with respectable people, and then the hippies kind of came in, and all of a sudden all the focus was on them, and they became identified as sort of the protest movement, and I think that was a very calculated move, because it's a lot easier to discredit and marginalize and a group of these long-haired, strangely dressed hippies with their peace signs and their peculiar music, and it was just, they were so foreign to mainstream America. They just looked like people from another world or something, and that made it much easier to marginalize what the anti-war movement that developed, because all the focus was on them. The media presented them as the face of the anti-war movement, the whole hippie generation, but they weren't. I mean, or at least they weren't the ones that originally got the ball rolling, and would have kept it rolling.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody always says that the hippies stopped the war, the 60s counterculture stopped the war, and yada yada, but they didn't.
Yeah.
It carried on for an entire decade after the hippies came along. It didn't end for an entire decade after close to 60,000 Americans had been shipped home in pine boxes. They didn't stop. I think they very much contributed to the extension of the war by diluting and taking a lot of the wind out of the sails of what would have been a very strong anti-war movement if they hadn't have appeared on the scene.
I'm going to reserve a comment, but I want to go to the last component of this email. The individual writes, the idea that Jimi Hendrix and Jim Morrison were intelligence agents is absurd, at least to me. The idea that intelligence agents enter their lives is not. How do both of you see the interaction? Go ahead, Dave.
I agree that the idea that intelligence operatives enter their lives is not absurd. But, you know, I mean, these people frequently kill their own, you know. I mean, just because somebody is gets whacked, it doesn't mean that they were one of the good guys, you know.
No.
So, you know, I haven't really gotten into Jimi Hendrix too much at all. All I mentioned was, you know, really the unusual circumstances of his death. He was not a huge part of the Laurel Canyon scene. He identified with San Francisco, although he did spend time in Laurel Canyon, and according to some reports, he had maintained a home there for a while. But I haven't really focused that much on him. Jim Morrison, I think, is much more suspect than Jimi Hendrix as far as whether he was a covert agent or not.
I'll have some more information for you that I want to run by it, but I want to at least vent what came to us through the listeners, because obviously, you know, that's why we do the show. So let's do this. Now, I don't know if you want to go here, but I do want to go here. And, you know, however you want to deal with it, that's fine. I just think it needs airing. We do a lot of things on symbology, Dave, and the bigger picture about, you know, I guess spiritual forces, if you will. I know that's kind of open-ended, but I'm going to just throw this out at you. Somebody wrote who was in Freemasonry, and he said, when I took my third degree in Masonry, we went through the story of Hiram Abiff and the three unworthy workers. And he goes on and on and on, but you know, I don't want to go through the whole, I mean, not that it's tedious whatsoever, but I want to get down to the kernel of what he was talking about, and that is, in Masonry, the Laurel branch, L-A-U-R-E-L, the Laurel, the bush, has a significant meaning in Freemasonry. Now, let me ask you this. I don't know if you've come upon it. I don't know if you will come upon it, or if you want to completely, I guess, dispense with it, but are we looking at a little something going on in Laurel Canyon that might have been dealing with a quasi-secret society? What's your thoughts on that?
I haven't really looked at it from that angle. I'm not familiar at all with the what you were talking about.
The symbology of Laurel, yeah.
Yeah, that has not come up in any regard in what I've read so far. So I haven't not looked at it at all from that angle.
All right. I'm wondering if that will come up. But also, what I'm wondering is, as you go deeper into the history of Laurel Canyon, which you did in part two to a certain extent, when you get back to Gene Harlow and Paul Byrne and such, I'm wondering if it even goes back to that. Who knows if you can uncover that? I don't know that you want to do that, or if it'll pop up all by itself, but I'm wondering if inlaid in the history of Laurel Canyon, if there wasn't a little something there that had a wink and a nod.
It's quite possible. I mean, you never know what's going to come up in this story, to be honest with you.
I know.
Last time I talked to you, you asked me about John Denver. Are you the one? I think you're the
yeah,
one.
Yeah, we talked about Dusendorf.
And I said, yeah, I haven't really looked at that because he's not a part of, you know, he hasn't come up in the story at all. Well, no sooner did I say it, the very next day he came up in the story. And sure enough, he moved to L.A. in 1964, and he actually joined a band that Roger McGuinn, I believe it was, of the Byrds had been in, same band as one of the Byrds, and turns out he was present. Supposedly, according to some reports, he was present at the infamous riot on the Sunset Strip, and I think it was November of 1966. So he actually. Come to find out, no sooner had I told you that he wasn't a part of it than I came to find out that he was a part of it, and you were right. He's a son of a career Air Force officer, I believe it was. And like a lot of other people in the stories, there's a lot of open questions about his death. He fits right.
Well,
he fits right in with the rest of these. Same family background, same mysterious death. It's amazing how many people are rolled up into this story. People you wouldn't even, you know, Glenn Campbell was very much a part of the scene. And, you know, I mean, these people that you wouldn't even, you know.
I know.
It's just, it's it's just weird. It's just the story just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and I don't even know what to do with it at this point. You know, there's just so many tentacles pointing out in so many directions. It's like which leads do I follow, and you know, and how far do I follow them? Because then they branch off into other, you know. Mm-hmm. So,
well, in fairness to you, if I remember correctly, you did not dispense with the fact that John Denver might have been part of it, but you said, you know, good point, and we left it at that, and lo and behold, you know, days after we spoke, you find out that, in fact, he was involved in the LC as well. We've got some more emails coming in. I want to put this in a kind of an order where we can, I don't know, I guess, do it in a way where it isn't hopscotch, but, and Karen, I've got your email, and I definitely want to get to it because if you want to know about Manson, I'm going to hold that off if we can. But we definitely want to address it. Also, Dave, we got this. We got it from Larry. He said, I just finished listening to the show on Laurel Canyon in the 60s today, and it blew my mind. Well, gee, that's where it all came from. I had never given much thought to rock stars and their heritage of military intelligence connections. I knew about Morrison, but chalked it off to rebelling against his father, that he, you know, lied about his parents being dead since he was ashamed of his father being a high-ranking military officer. Today, when all these icons of the 60s rock counterculture turn out to have military intelligence connections, then Dave's question was very appropriate. My question here, I guess, is this. What do you suppose the odds are that all of that just came purely together by chance?
I think the odds are astronomical, to be honest with you. And, you know, I haven't gotten into it yet. I'm going to in a future installment, but I can give you a little sneak preview. And that is another aspect of the story is the Hollywood Young Turks, what were known as the Young Turks angle, because they were very much the young Hollywood stars who were also very much a part of the Laurel Canyon scene.
Peter Fonda. What year was that when the Young Turks had their bones?
From 1965 on, it was, you know, Peter Fonda, Bruce Dern, Jack Nicholson, Warren Beatty, Jane Fonda. Well, she wasn't a young Turk. I guess she would be a Turkette or something.
Okay.
You know, there's this whole group of people that also Canyon. Peter Fonda had a place there. Dennis Hopper did. Sal Mineo lived right at the mouth of the canyon. So this whole little clique of young Hollywood actors who were making the scene on the Sunset Strip clubs and were living in Laurel Canyon and making movies in Laurel Canyon. I don't know if we talked about that last time. The Monkees movie.
Oh, yeah. Head. When Nicholson's in there, yep.
Yeah, and The Trip and Easy Rider. Those movies all sort of came out of Laurel Canyon. They were very much part of the scene. And I've been looking into their past, and some of them have even more troubling connections than the rock stars that they were hanging out with. I'll give one example: Bruce Dern.
He
co-starred with Fonda in The Trip, and you know, he was very much a part of that scene. And his uncle on his mother's side, his mother was Jean McLeish. His uncle was Archibald McLeish, who was Skull and Bones, class of 1915, the year before Prescott Bush, who was class of 1916. And his grandfather on his dad's side was a former Secretary of War, which was what we call the Secretary of Defense
now, yep.
Slightly more honest times. And his godparents were First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt and Adlai Stevenson, the guy who twice lost to
Eisenhower,
yeah. So, I mean, his family, he comes directly from this whole stew of, you know, Skull and Bones and Department of Defense. And, I mean, just, so, and that's true also of several of the others. So it was not just the musicians who had gathered in the canyon who were the offspring of the military intelligence comp. It was all the young Hollywood actors that they were hanging out with as well. So, I mean, you know, at some point you got to say, how many coincidences does it take to make a conspiracy, you know? And to me, I think we passed the threshold a long time ago on this story, you know. So that would be, I guess, my answer. Yeah, it's way too much for me to accept as all coincidental.
I'm just going to enter this now. This is about you, not about me. Although I was there, and, you know, anyway, I mean, I saw it all. I went through a bunch of stages. But the one thing that I now question when I look back, and when we talk about it now, is that the whole introduction also of LSD, I think, is very, very interesting. Ken Kesey, who I revered as a writer, you know, he's the author of Sometimes a Great Notion and One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Of course, he is the subject of Tom Wolfe's The Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test. But when they had acid, and it was not against the law because nobody knew they had it, although, of course, it is suspected that the Army intelligence created it. And, of course, they had the concerts out on the coast where the Warlocks played, who later became the Grateful Dead.
Yeah, nice name, huh?
Yeah, well, there you go. And then, of course, the famous trip on the bus with Neil Cassidy driving as they go across the coast, and they eventually end on the East Coast, and they were talking to Leary and then came back. But, you know, the one thing, and then I don't want to go into it now, so I'll just leave it there, but, I mean, if we can go to that later on about the whole introduction to LSD, that's interesting, too. But let me go to
that. Oh, yeah, and the fact that it remained legal for as long as it did during that time, you know, when there was supposedly all this harassment and everything going on, and yet LSD remained perfectly legal.
Yeah, I mean, the cops couldn't arrest you because there was no law against it.
You couldn't smoke a joint, but you could drop acid, you know.
Oh, well, you get your ass busted for smoking a joint, but if you're doing acid, they just let you alone.
Yeah, I mean, seems very odd, doesn't it, in retrospect,
yes,
that they wouldn't have immediately clamped down on that? I mean,
yeah, and that's why I'm saying, but I think you're going to come to that also at another time, but I, you know, just to kind of whet the appetites of people, that's the one thing that I think really bothered me, how straight up Kesey was. But, and of course, because Kesey had worked on a psych ward, which gave him the fodder for the book One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yes, yes.
He also studied at Stanford, which is the Stanford Research Institute, and I can't hook them both up, but it's kind of interesting as well. But that for another day. Now, we got a comment. It said, I am fascinated regarding the links between these people. Someone knew someone who worked with someone else, and in the end, there are often bad endings to people, mysterious deaths and such. The fact that so much of the music was so good, agreed, so brilliant in many cases, agreed, was the music itself generally contrived as some part of some plan, in quotes, to change society. I would love to hear more about the parents or other family members, even in some cases the celebrity themselves, being involved in intelligence. What has been the overall goal, and has it been met? And lastly, was Manson suspect as well as strange intelligence connections? All right, that's a lot of stuff, and probably not all for this moment. But let's do this. First of all, I thought the music was excellent. I think it was.
I firmly believe it. I still have the records in my collection. I mean, for a very long time after that, there wasn't anything worth listening to on the music. I mean, the music of the 70s and 80s was pretty much wretched, you know. I think the music was very good, and it stood the test of time. To what degree it was contrived, I couldn't really tell you, but you know, I would definitely agree that the music was it definitely stood up to the test of time, in my opinion.
And mine too. And again, but you know what this goes back to. And, Dave, I don't want to spend any time on this. If sometime in the future you want to do something, that's fine, because we can't open this oyster right here. But, I mean, we have treated the issue, whether or not the Beatles were handled by a composer of some note who has gone, like, below the radar screen, and that would be Theodore Adorno, and whether or not they got together in England, because Adorno supposedly fleed Germany prior to World War II, and John Colin and his conspirators hierarchy and some others put the Beatles with Adorno together so that they were trying to get something done. Now, that's like for another time. Just leave that where it is. But the fact that there is some kind of suggestion that rock and roll was being handled in some fashion. But, like, again, not for another time. But moving on to another question, and let me get back to this again. Okay. What about, if we can, as far as you've gone with this, let's just kind of flip over, because there's a couple of people that want to know how much Manson had a hand in what was taking place in that particular era.
Well, he was very much a part of the scene. Virtually all of the big name musicians that came out of there in that era knew him. Most of them don't like to admit it, but some of them have. One of the guys from Canned Heat admitted that they used to party with the Manson family. You know, he auditioned for Neil Young. He auditioned for Jerry Garcia of the Grateful Dead. He auditioned for Dennis Wilson. He was recorded by Dennis Wilson. He was recorded by Terry Melcher, Doris Day's son, who was producer of the Byrds and various other bands. And, I mean, he was known to hang out at Moss's house. He's been reported to have been at John Phillips' house. Some of his followers reportedly lived at the log cabin that Frank Zappa was the ringmaster at, you know, in late in 1968, according to Ed Sanders' book, The Family. He was all over the place. His fingerprints are all over that whole music scene. You find references to him constantly throughout, he or one of his followers, particularly Bobby Beausoleil.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce it. We were discussing that earlier, but Beautiful Son, by the way, he was very much a part of the scene as well. He actually lived in Laurel Canyon for a while and was the original rhythm guitarist for mm-hmm. the band that became Love when they were known as the Grassroots.
Oh, yeah.
And Tex Watson, who was the leader of the expedition that went to the Cielo Drive house, he lived in Laurel Canyon on Wonderland Avenue. And yeah, I mean, they're just everywhere. They're all over the story. It's unavoidable. You just keep bumping into one or more members of the Manson family around every turn, pretty much.
It is interesting, though, because it almost seemed, though, he was at least dignified to some extent as having a little talent. I don't think, I mean, from what I can remember, and this is a long time ago, I mean, the Wilsons from the Beach Boys weren't necessarily blowing him off. I'm just sure that, you know, when he came into your living room, he was kind of scary.
I would imagine, except that he always brought a huge gaggle of women with him, you know, and, you know, from the descriptions that I've read, I mean, he just basically brought this troop of young girls with him that would just pretty much do and service anyone that, you know, Manson wanted to get on the good side of, so, you know.
All right, so in other words, he had a way of, he had a calling card, didn't he?
He had a calling card, yeah, a calling card that was very attractive to Dennis Wilson and his two sidekicks, Terry Melcher and Greg Jacobson, which was, yeah, these just young, attractive, adoring women who would cater to their every whim.
All right, I just want to let people know, too, we've been talking with Dave McGowan. The website, Dave, is davesweb.cnchost.com. But, you know, the link always goes up. Your link always goes up with the audio. Not a big deal. But if you're listening right now, if you want to do that, you go to davesweb.cnchost.com. You can pick up all the newsletters. They're right there at the top. The website's also known as the Center for an Informed. For what? An Informed what?
America.
America, okay. That's when my printer stopped. Oh, classy, isn't it? All right, no problem with that.
Yeah, there's a couple. I should have parts 5 and 6 up in the next few days, hopefully. They're nearing completion. So,
well, I don't think anybody's in a hurry as long as, you know, it comes out and it comes out right. I mean,
some of my readers are. I keep getting emails. What happened? You were putting them out, you know, every year, and now all of a sudden, I'm like, just give me a chance. Yeah, I got a reboot. I got a lot of material to dig through and organize, and, you know. I want to make sure I get it right. I mean, there's so much bad information in all the mainstream accounts. I mean, you read something in one book, and the next day you read a different version in another book that completely contradicts the first version that you read. And I mean, trying to sort out the truth from the Hollywood mythology and legend making is I want to make sure I get it as accurate as possible.
You know, I say, I don't want to waste a whole bunch of minutes. And we got something else from two people, three people that kind of resonate with the same question. I'm going to throw that to you. And I don't know, you know, I don't know if we're going to have this time. But, I mean, that's why I say the series goes on. And as long as you're okay, at your convenience, we can go on and you know, delve into some of these things. But, yeah. You know, I mean, when I would, you know, when all this stuff was going on, I'm like 17 years old. But I'm following it through the Daily News, you know, when I lived in the New York area. And you look at this stuff, and, you know, to this day, you know, I try to think back as to how I just, like, assimilated all this stuff, or maybe I just offed it, because it was so bizarre. And of course, the Vietnam thing was going on. I really do believe that all of us just took this stuff in, we threw it away, and we went on with our lives, because there's no world we were going to get deep into this and not get brain damage. So, you know, I'm just amazed at all that passed through us at that time. As much as people today, you know, yak about martial law and police state, that all might be happening. But, you know, we really have to take a look. I don't know how you feel about this, but, I mean, I look back to 70 to 75, and I'm like, I don't even know how we get through this. I mean, if you want to crack in on that, by all means. But, I mean, it can get a lot stranger.
Yeah, it's a very strange world we live in. The older I get, the more I realize that, and the deeper you dig down these rabbit holes, the more you realize that it definitely is a very strange. I mean, I don't know that anything. There's very little that seems that can shock me anymore. You know, it's the weird thing about the whole hippie movement is that it just seemed to happen so fast, you know. And I mean, how does that happen? That, you know, I mean, it had to start somewhere, you know. I mean, how do all these kids just all of a sudden end up adopting this completely different lifestyle? That, you know, I mean, different hairstyles, different clothing styles, different music, and I mean, how did that just happen so quickly? That the all these kids just all of a sudden woke up one day with long hair and bad clothes, you know.
But Dave, the thing is, that happened without VHS. I mean, whatever it is, the hell is it called? You know, I don't know. What's all the rock and roll things on, you know, on the MTV? Okay, this happened without MTV, without BET, and all these videos. This happened without wall to wall, 24/7 TV. This happened without that. That's the thing I think is most interesting. Is because they didn't have that medium to get to everybody all the time, where the mom and dad were watching what you were watching on TV.
We definitely weren't all tied in as much to this. To where we're all the entire country, every remote corner of the country is now fed the same daily diet of crap, you know, from our news and entertainment media and through the internet and whatnot. And yet it still just sprung up. I mean, just out of nowhere, all of a sudden we had this whole what very quickly became the largest countercultural movement in American history, just sort of out of nowhere almost. Mm-hmm. You know, and it is very odd that it happened like that, you know. I mean, why this such a drastic countercultural movement, you know? I mean, where everything about them was sort of foreign to small town, you know, mainstream America. I mean, everything, their look, their music, their attitude, and, you know, I mean, yeah, it's odd. It's very odd in retrospect
And let's hopefully revisit that in time to come. We got a couple of comments. One from Carpet Max said, if he's got kids, married and bored and turned collectivist. Well, I can't argue with that.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Also, we got another comment. Doesn't Shirley MacLaine have nebulous family military origins or connections?
Shirley MacLaine is Warren Beatty's brother, obviously.
That's right.
And he was again one of the young Turks that hung out with that crowd. His father was supposedly a psychiatrist, psychologist, or a psychology professor or something like that. But I mean, he moved around in an unusual way. I think he was like born in like Alexandria, Virginia, I think.
And what a surprise.
Yeah, and then they moved to Norfolk, Virginia, you know, the largest naval base in the world. And then after that they moved to, I think, Arlington, Virginia, like the home of the Pentagon. And so, you know, I mean, his whole early life was spent hopping around between these little, you know, military intelligence suburbs of Washington, D.C. So
mm-hmm.
even though, you know, his father didn't officially work for the military, but, you know, you got to sort of, a lot of times you got to kind of read between
the lines.
One of the things that surprised me really about this story is that so many of these people's military intelligence connections are right out there up front, because usually you do have to read between the lines. I mean, CIA and all its affiliated spy organizations, they're secret you know, they operate in secrecy. That's by definition. So they don't advertise, you know, their membership. So, you know, usually you have to read between the lines and look, you know, where did this person grow up? Or, where did the family move around to, and what circles did they, you know, travel and whatnot. But, you know, so Warren Beatty's kind of one of those cases where, and Shirley MacLaine also, obviously, because she's his sister. It's one of those where you kind of have to read between the lines. But, you know, the amazing thing to me is that so much of this story, you don't have to read between the lines. And if there's that many people there that have open military and intelligence connections, then how many of the other ones had hidden, you know, military and intelligence connections?
I tell you what, we got two heavy-duty questions. I'm going to ask you to just give, if you could, a cursory answer to them both. We can visit this later on, because I think you're going to come upon this if you haven't already. But we'll revisit this. One message was they had mind control, subliminal psychic messages put on records. Preston Nichols says this. He participated in this at Montauk. All right, that's one statement. Is there a possibility, whether it was backmasked or whatever, that there were certain things in there? I don't know. I mean, are we looking at something that was triggering to a generation that might have been medicated to some extent?
It's possible. I have not really looked in any great depth at that aspect at all. I remember when I was a kid, the big backward masking controversy when I was, I don't know, probably in my young teens or something. I remember there was a big thing about it, in Led Zeppelin's records. I can remember me and my friends trying to spin a Led Zeppelin, you know, old 33 and a third final record backwards on an
make it talk
to see if we could hear, you know, and a Beatles one too, to see if we could hear Paul's Dead or whatever the hell was supposed to be.
I know.
I remember doing it, yeah, but I, you know, as an adult and, you know, as a researcher, I have not really, I haven't really looked into that aspect of it.
All right, and that might come in time. And also, I do find it interesting, though, that they would plant that stuff in there, but that might have been a really great marketing scheme later on to get everybody to buy back albums. We can't overlook the fact that that was a really good marketing gimmick.
Yeah, I remember Stairway to Heaven supposedly had that. I can't remember.
You, My Sweet Satan, yeah.
Is that what it was? I remember playing that. And yeah,
I can't hear it.
And Revolution Number 9 or something was,
yep,
supposed to say I buried Paul.
Paul is dead.
Yeah, well, we checked into it. I remember checking into it. I don't remember if we heard anything or not. It probably depended on our chemical balance at the time.
The thing is, some of us never checked out. Okay, we got another good one for you here. This will only take about 3 hours to discuss. I love it. I wish these people would call in, but they don't. Anyway, I'm okay. Whether they're shy or they're at work, it's fine. Boy, I tell you, this is a good one. Are either of you familiar with the lore that early in the Third Reich, German scientists experimented with Nepalese and other indigenous shamanistic chants, combining them with repetitive percussive patterns? in a quest to develop early NLP, which would be neuro-linguistic programming, and brainwashing techniques. It was suspected that they created proto-rock and rock and roll music before being ordered to shelve their findings. Might their research and results have been British war booty for Tavistock to perfect? Actually, Dave, that makes a lot of sense if you've come across some of the information that I've come across, or, you know, the listeners have. But, you know, this is what I was saying to you about whether or not it was true about Adorno and the Beatles. Had they crafted music along, you know, the lines of trying to influence young people? And I would have to say this. Right now, with the longevity that hip-hop has had along with the rap, I mean, I got to think that there's something in there. So I won't say anything more. You know where I'm going with that. Do you want to address whether or not, you know, they built in some things that deal with, you know, alpha, beta states of the brain?
I couldn't really speak to that. I'm not familiar with the specific line of research that she,
or he or she or whatever, yeah.
He or whatever was referencing there, you know. I mean, I know that the CIA and probably British intelligence did, you know, from what I understand, get a hold of all of the, secure all of the records of all of the experiments that were conducted on the terminal, the so-called terminal experiments and whatnot that were conducted by Nazi researchers. And, you know, a lot of that had to do with human tolerances, you know, human tolerance, mm-hmm. various forms of torture and pain, and just how far you could push a person in various ways before they died, you know, as far as sleep deprivation and food deprivation and you know, sensory overload and all of these different heinous things that they did to see how long the people could endure it before they actually died. And, of course, I mean, all of that research has applications both in mind control and in interrogations, in both cases of which you want to, you know, torture your victim as close as you can to the point of death without actually killing them, because if you kill them, then you've lost your subject, you know, or your source of information.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I mean, I have no doubt that they do indeed have all of that information and that it's utilized in various unsavory ways, but I'm not familiar specifically with the line of research that she was discussing or, you know, technicalities of you know, music containing you know,
subliminal
rhythms or you know, backwards masked instructions or anything like that. It's a little beyond my level of expertise.
No, and none of us really know. And actually, I would say that they're ahead of the curve. Only that they've heard other individuals who spoke to that is not necessarily where you were going. That might be indeed where you wind up. But, and yeah, I didn't want to jump you with that, but there seems to be something going on, and yet none of us really know, and nobody's really come out to say, look, you know, what's going on here is definitely a trigger.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, what's this guy, Augustus, the big acid guru of the 60s up in San Francisco that had all the military and intelligence connections, and had served as an intelligence officer, and his family history contained, like, all these, you know, high-ranking officials and whatnot. Augustus Stanley? Was that Owsley?
Owsley. Okay. Yep.
Yeah, he was, didn't he, started out, I believe, as the Grateful Dead's sound technician. You know, he was the one that sort of shaped their sound, and he had a background in, you know, psychological warfare and intelligence operations, and then he became the, you know, the big acid producer and distributor that showed up routinely at all the big rock festivals and handed out, you know, like, you know, massive quantities of free drugs to people. And yeah, so he started out as a, and there were other, as I recall from Martin Lee's book Acid Dreams, I believe there were other people that were involved as sound technicians for some of these various bands that had like these intelligence connections. So, you know, it is quite possible that they were tailoring a specific sound, you know, or a specific pattern of sounds or specific rhythms or, you know, whatever the case may be. But, you know, again, I just don't have the technical knowledge to really address that in any sort of, you know, scientific way.
No, and you need not. But it'll be interesting as you go, you know, through your research, whether that'll come up, and not even if you want to delve in that, but if you actually, you know, that does ding up more or less where your research leads you. I think we can admit, though, David, and we're running, you know, about 3 minutes left to go, that certainly this didn't happen on itself, did it? I mean, you know, I can't speak for music during the 30s and the 40s and what they were hoping to get out of that, but I'm assuming that, you know, perhaps 60s and 70s music probably had some kind of embedded edge that music before did not have. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, it certainly was a revolutionary new sound. I mean, it didn't sound like anything that had come along before. It was, you know, it wasn't like a continuation of what had previously been considered, you know, rock music, you know, as in the, you know, Elvis Presley, Everly Brothers kind of mold, you know. So, yeah, I mean, it was a completely new and different sound, and it was a completely new and different look that the hippies and flower children had, and, you know, this simultaneous mass infusion of drugs, you know, into the counterculture. Just there was a lot of things that were completely, you know, new and different that all sort of came together all at the same time, which is, you know, very odd, you know, that to my mind that all of these elements would just sort of spring up, you know, simultaneously all at the same time and across, you know, pretty much across country. At a time like, you know, as we were discussing earlier, we weren't sort of all plugged into this sort of mass consciousness.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this. If you were to look at one group that you felt probably had the most influence in politically affecting rock and roll listeners' minds, what group would you think? Off the top of your head.
I guess it would probably be the Beatles. Although I haven't really looked into the whole British invasion angle, so I can't, you know, I don't really know much about them, but I would say probably the Beatles, you know, and specifically John Lennon, yes.
And that would bring us also to another very interesting situation with what
or
happened.
Or maybe Bob Dylan, I don't, but no, probably the Beatles. But go ahead.
Okay, well, no, it's just that, well, we're going to pick this up because we're out of time, but, I mean, you look at what happened to Lennon, is that also a coincidence? Listen, thanks, Dave McGowan, for being with us. Folks, you can go to his website, and you'll see the link on my site, and you can plug in to see what's going on here. Dave, thanks a lot for being with us, and we'll talk to you in the near future, bro.
Definitely, yeah. I mean, there'll be many more parts going up, and if you see something you want to talk about, I'll be more than happy to come back.
Remember those words. We'll be back. Thank you very much, Dave.
All right, thanks.
All right, bye-bye.